Hello, investors, and welcome to our session here today. So one of the big names is coming out with their earnings after the market closes here today, and I'm just going to make a quick adjustment here. And as I was saying, one of our larger companies, larger cap companies, as far as the S&P 500 is coming out with their earnings after the market today, that would be Nike. With those kinds of situations, is there an opportunity there for potentially overnight profits? Well, that'll be our primary focus of our discussion here today. But before we get too far along, let's go ahead and pop through our disclosures. And just a reminder, investors, with regards to enclosures, with regards to disclosures, do keep in mind that options carry a high level of risk and are not suitable for all investors. The information here is for general informational purposes only and should not be considered an individualized recommendation or endorsement of any particular security, chart pattern, or investment strategy. Schwab does not recommend the use of technical analysis as a sole mean of investment research. We do use the paperMoney software application here. This is for educational purposes only. We want to remember that successful virtual trading during a one-time period does not guarantee successful investing of extra funds during a later time period, as market conditions do change continuously. And of course, investing involves risk, including the potential loss of principal. Also, investors, just a reminder that short options can be assigned at any time up to expiration, regardless of the in-the-money amount. And in-the-money option has a higher risk of being assigned early. It's important to keep that in mind because the paper-money virtual trading application will not assign a short position early, which is different from what could occur in an actual real trading account. And with that, let's go ahead and jump right in here. And to do that, I'm going to bring up the Thinkorswim platform here, and we'll just pick right in here and get going. While that's coming up, I do want to come over here and check in the chat. We're going to just welcome everybody here. So I want to welcome Scott and David and Derek and Kathy, and truth will always prevail. Along with Jason, it looks like we have Barb Armstrong over there helping us out in the chat window as well. Great to have Barb here with us as always. Very knowledgeable investor. Do feel free to send your questions over there to Barb. I'll also try to peek over there periodically to see if there's something that I can help out with where I have advantage of the platform. Why don't we just start off, investor, just by quickly looking at some of the major indices, kind of get an idea of what our sentiment would be in relationship to the market. Then we'll jump right over and we'll take a look at Nike and discuss that in relationship to the earnings. But right now, what I have up here is I have a chart of the S&P 500. In fact, I sent a little tweet over on this a little bit earlier, about 20 or 30 minutes ago. And you can see the S&P 500 has been moving up rather rapidly. By the way, do you still call those tweets or do you call them X's? I don't know, but anyway, you know, we can see the S&P 500 came up here. We had this big red candle right here. Then we gapped up into the middle of that red candle. And so that yesterday's big red candle there, it completely engulfs today's candle. We don't know if that's going to be the way it will be at the close. That's what we're currently looking at. Now, if you see a big red candle like this and then a gap up, so the big red candle completely engulfs that, that's referred to as a bullish harami. Now, bullish haramis do tend to have more validity if they occur after a more significant move to the downside. But if you do have a big candle like that, completely engulfs the secondary candle, that's a bullish harami. It does suggest a potential change in direction from that move to the downside to possibly recovering, moving to the upside. So we could have seen a pause in the market yesterday and possibly kick in and continue to move up. We see the same thing over here on the NASDAQ, and we see the same thing over here on the Russell. A lot of those bullish haramis going on right now. Okay. Well, let's do this. Let's go ahead and shift gears here and come right over. Let's just jump right in on our discussion here with Nike. We want to talk about Nike. We want to talk about Nike from an earnings trade perspective. Then following that, we do want to go out and look at some previous trades that we have done, see if they're in need of any management and those types of things. Let's start off here, though, by pulling up Nike. I'm going to do an NKE here. I believe that's still their symbol, and it is. So here we have Nike. And you can see that on the Thinkorswim platform right here, we've got these little icons down here that let us know when the earnings announcement is. If I come over here to this icon right here and roll over it, it says earnings 12/21/23 after the market. So we have an earnings announcement coming out after the market. Today is Thursday. Tomorrow is Friday. You know, from a theoretical perspective, we could put on an earnings trade using options where those options would expire tomorrow, and we basically know whether or not we had profit or loss over a very short period of time. We just want to keep in mind that we could have both profit or loss, you know, either way. want to do here today is we want to look at two strategies. One will give us a rather quick answer, rather quick and abrupt. Another one will give us a little bit more flexibility in the event the underlying security moves against us. But looking at the chart right here, I do want to identify a little indicator we have over here on our chart. We've got these two horizontal lines right here. Those horizontal lines represent what is called the market maker move. This is a proprietary indicator that is only available on the Thinkorswim platform. The formula for it is proprietary. It does a fairly good job, but it is far from perfect. But basically what it's trying to forecast the potential move of the underlying security in relationship to an upcoming announcement. Now I have this so it draws on my chart here, and I also have a label up here that tells me it from a percentage standpoint. So the market maker move is currently $7.48, which is about 6.13% of the price. Now, if you wanted to pull it up on your Thinkorswim platform, and basically just come up here to the trade tab and click on trade. When you click on trade, right up here, you'll see three little M's right here. Then you'll see a plus or minus $7.48. And that's just, and what that is suggesting is there's something going on with the stock. Most often it's going to be an earnings announcement, and the potential move that is being forecasted here is up by approximately $7.50 or down by approximately $7.50. Now, if you'd like to have it so you can bring it up here so it shows up on your chart, what I've done is let me put it this way. What I will do is, following our session here today, if you look at the YouTube window and you go down to the bottom, you'll see a description. That's a short description. When you click on the word more in that description, that will open up and give you some additional details. And when you look at those additional details, you'll see a link in there that says Market Maker Move Link. And you can use that link to bring it over here on the Thinkorswim platform so that you'll have it as a study that you can use. By the way, when you see that link, you should just copy the entire link, come up here to where it says setup, click on setup, click on open shared item, paste the link right in there, and then just follow along on the screens. There will be a place, there will be a box where you'll want to give it a name. You definitely want to give it a name so that you'll be able to find it. You can call it Market Maker Move or anything you want, but you'll get to a box where after you click on preview and you bring it up and you'll have an opportunity to save it, you definitely want to give it a name so you can find it. So when you come up here to studies and choose edit studies, it'll be over here under the name that you gave it, okay? But this is our suggested move here. So there's a couple of strategies that frequently come to mind with investors looking at earnings announcement. One is that kind of that quick hit strategy. That's referred to as an iron condor. That's where we're selling short call verticals up in this area outside the market maker move and selling short put verticals down below this area outside the market maker move. And as long as the price stays within this zone over the earnings announcement, you tend to put yourself in a fairly good place for profitability. It's not guaranteed because we're not sure exactly where we'll get filled when we actually have to exit these things, but it does tend to put you in a fairly good place in relationship to that. Now, you always want to keep in mind, investors, that because earnings is such a random event, we'll use a market maker move to get an idea of where the stock is forecasted to be, but we know that anything can happen. And so for that reason, because anything can happen, I would say when you're looking at these trades, you may say to yourself, okay, how often am I going to be successful on these trades? What I would suggest is use your paper trading account and make that determination with regards to a limited number of stocks. You may only want to do this on three or four stocks to kind of get an idea for those individual stocks and to get a little bit of a better feel of how accurate the market maker move may be in relationship to the type of stocks that you tend to trade, particularly over announcements like this, okay? But why don't we start off by just taking a look at an iron condor, then we'll shift gears and we'll look at what's called a straddle strangle swap, and we'll kind of compare and contrast the two of those. You know, I'm kind of leaning towards putting both of them on here so that we can follow up next time. That may get us a step closer as far as selecting which one of those may be the most appropriate for you with regards to your own individual investing style. But let's go ahead and start off with the iron condor, because that tends to be the one that investors tend to kind of wrap their mind around and understand fairly quickly. So with regards to the short call vertical, we want to be above 129, so possibly a 130, 131 short call vertical. And down here on the short put verticals, we want to be below the 114.42, so possibly a 114 or maybe even possibly a 113.112 coming down there with regards to the short put vertical. So let's come over here then to the analyze page. Here we are over here, and I've got Nike right here. I'm going to choose add simulated trades. We can run some simulations and see what this all looks like. Choose add simulated trades right here. We're going to look at overnight profits, a quick hit here. I'm not sure what this is, what exactly this will look like, but we'll find out here momentarily. But I'm going to go with the 22nd December. These options are going to expire tomorrow. So we're looking at this from the standpoint of some quick overnight profits or some quick overnight losses, okay? And when we're talking about the upside, again, we want to be maybe 130 on the upside and 113 on the downside with regards to our short verticals here. So we're here. Let's find 130 down here on the call side right here. There is 130 right there. So I'm going to do a right click right here at the 130. We'll set up the 130, 131 short call as part of an iron condor, but we're going to have to make the adjustment with regards to the put side of that. So here's our 130. I'm going to do right click right here on the bid price. I'm going to choose analyze sell trade, and I'm going to come in here and choose iron condor, and there's our call. So our calls are where we want them to be at the 130, 131, but our puts, we want our puts to be at like 113, 112. So I'm going to change the strike prices here on our puts to move them down below that market maker move point. So rather than selling a 129 right here, I'm going to click right there, and we'll bring this down to 113. So we're selling the 113, and we're going to buy over here, and we're going to buy the 112 right there. And it looks like we've got a credit here of 38 cents, or a forecasted credit there of 38 cents. So if we're able to capture 38 cents, and we may not be able to capture 38 cents, but it is a possibility, okay, then what kind of return on risk would we be looking at this? In fact, I'm going to, let me move this down to 35, just in case we have to give up a little bit of that in order to get a filled order here at 35. So if we're looking at this in 35, then what is going to be our return on risk on this trade? Let me just throw that out to all of you to put your thinking caps on, so to speak. What do you what do you think we've got here with regards to our return on risk if we're sitting here at a 35-cent credit and our strike prices are a dollar wide? What's going to be our theoretical return on risk? Now, there tends to be a little bit of a lag between the time I ask a question and questions show up over there in the chat window. That's just kind of the way the whole broadcasting thing works, all right? So I'll go ahead and answer my question. I'll peek over there in the chat window and see if we have several correct answers. That usually tends to be the situation. But let's come over here. I'm going to grab a calculator here so that we can run this calculation. So there's a dollar difference between the strike prices. Now, do keep in mind, investors, that when we're talking about doing an iron condor, you can only lose on one side or the other. You can't lose on both sides at the same time. So for that reason, our risk on this, even though we have two short verticals, we're either, if the underlying price could blow us out to the top, or it could blow us out to the bottom, but it can't do both at the same time. So our risk is just going to be the distance between the strike prices, whether it's just basically going to be the difference between the two strike prices minus our credit. The nice thing is this credit equals two credits, so we have two credits while we're risking just one side or the other. So what is our theoretical return on risk here? Looks like a lot of you guys got the number right there. Looks like David's got it. Yeah, we got to... There's our credit. Our credit is our theoretical maximum gain. And again, this does not include transaction fees. We divide that by the distance between the strike prices minus our credit. That's our theoretical max loss. And that's going to be 65 right here. And so that gives us, I'm going to go with the math you guys have out over there. I'm going to go with 53%. That looks like it's going to be 53%. I'll go ahead and grab my calculator just to double check. But those look like good clean numbers to me. Okay, let's just do it on our calculator right here. So we've got the distance between the strike prices is $1. Okay, we got $1 minus our credit here of $35, gives us our theoretical loss here of $65. We take our maximum gain then of $35, and we divide it by our maximum loss then of $65, and we have 53.8%. But this is what we're looking at here is the potential of a return of 53% over one day. 53% over one day. Let's see what this looks like on our risk reward graph. So I on the Thinkorswim platform, I came up here to analyze. I went into add simulated trades. We added our simulated trade down here. Now we're going to see what it looks like on the risk profile. And to do that, I'm going to come up here and switch to risk profile. And this is what our trade looks like from a risk standpoint. I'm going to set, notice over here we have zero. This is our risk to the downside. This is our profit to the upside. Notice we're risking more to the downside than we stand to gain. But the nice thing about this is where we're currently trading. We can go up and make money. We can go down and make money. We can stay where we're at and make money. It's a little bit tricky on an earnings announcement, though, because we can go way up on an earnings announcement. We can go way down on an earnings announcement. So we want to remember that as well. Let's come over here. I'm going to just click right here and choose set slices to break even. There's our break even point. By the way, again, just ignore the probabilities. I would say at best, we'd be looking at probabilities of success of maybe 50%. But these are break even points. So again, the investors, just to reiterate, a potential 53% over one day. What does that tell us? It tells us that this is an extremely risky trade with a vast amount of unknowns. Anything can happen on this thing, okay? So it offers a high return, but there's also a high level of risk because of all the unknowns and all the randomness that can come about as a result of an earnings announcement and news related to that, okay? So we don't even discuss the probabilities in here. I mean, we could set them up theoretically to go from here to tomorrow and get probably been the money and the like, but it's just not realistic, okay? But we do want to identify our break-even points here on our Aaron Condor. So this is our break-even point to the upside. This is our break-even point to the downside. We want to see what these look like in relationship to the market maker move on the chart. So come over here and choose set slices to chart right there. Here we are. So here is our break-even point on our short call vertical. Here's our break-even point on our short put vertical. Both of those are sitting outside the market maker move. So, excuse me, if we're comfortable with this, then who's comfortable going with a market maker move right here, would be okay to go ahead and send this in. Why don't we go ahead and send this in so that we can follow up with it next time to kind of see what happened actually when the earnings announcement came out. Were we able to stay within this zone as forecast, or did we blow out of the zone? Again, we know that anything can happen. But come back over to the analyze tab. I'm going to do right click right here and choose create duplicate order. I'm only going to do one of these because because of the randomness and the risk. I'm going to go ahead and undo my padlock here. If I can get 37, I'll take it. That gives me a few more bucks here, and it also decreases my max loss by a few dollars as well. We'll go ahead and with this then, I'm going to go ahead and do confirm and send. And we are in our selecting an option strategy, which is where we want to be. We can read our buying power effect here as 63. That's our theoretical max loss right here. And our max loss is actually given to us right here. So our max loss right here is 63. Our maximum profit is 37. That's our credit. I always want to remember to read the red. Please know you've selected a weekly option series with non-standard expiration date. So let's go ahead and send that in. And we're not getting filled. So we'll come up here, see if we can see where we need to go to find a market on this thing. Up here to monitor and working orders. And do a right click here on this bad boy and choose cancel replace. Well, let's come down to 35. I thought we might have to come off a little bit. I don't want to come off too much, though. We'll come down to 35. Let's see if we can get a fill at 35. Confirm and send. And we're filled. Now, investors, this is a paper money account. Of course, if you were in a live trading account, you'd probably give that a little bit more time to get filled, but we don't have time to we don't have that kind of time in our sessions here today. How are we doing on time? Looks like we're doing okay on time. So what I want to do here then is let's take a quick look at, well, what I'm going to do is I'm going to Let's look at our previous trades, because I want to look at our previous trades and look at those and look at trade management around those. And then provided we have time, then I want to swing back out and look at a straddle strangle swap. And if we don't have time to put the straddle strangle swap here in this session, how are we doing on that time frame? Yeah. What I'll attempt to do is I'll attempt to do it after our session. But I think it's important to look at our previous trades as well, because I think learning about previous trades and following up on all those previous trades to kind of see how they did, I think that's every bit as important and every bit as beneficial as putting on new trades. That is extremely important. Okay. So we've got that one in, and we'll swing back over here then and look at our existing trades. I do want to cover a trade though that we did, that I did a little bit of management on last time when we talked about it. And this was a trailing stop loss that we did on Walgreens Boot Alliance. Some of you remember on Walgreens Boot Alliance, I believe we did a couple things. We did a long call and we did a long call vertical just to kind of compare and contrast the two. So let's come up here to account statement right here. There's Walgreens Boot Alliance. Let's go back and we're going to go back here 30 days and see this. So this was our entry here on Walgreens Boot Alliance. We entered these trades back on 12/7, and we just wanted to compare and contrast the performance of a long call. This is our long call right here. We bought a 23 long call. That's just a separate transaction. We bought that, and then we also did a long call vertical. And the reason we wanted to do both of these is because the long call vertical has a lower break-even price. We wanted to look at that lower break-even price and see how that comes into play over time. Well, fortunately, with regards to this particular paper money trade on Walgreens Boot Alliance, the stock took a very bullish move. So actually both the long call and both the long call vertical performed quite nicely. And in fact, when we got together here, the following right here looks like we're on 12/14. So this was a week later. At that particular point in time, we talked about our long call vertical. At that particular point in time, we could get out at more than 80% of our maximum gain and do it after being in the trade for 1 week. Now, that was due in part to some very strong bullish movement here with regards to Walgreens Boot Alliance. In fact, let's take a look at the chart here to kind of get an idea. Walgreens Boot Alliance, there we are there. And you can see that, excuse me, I think we were entering the trade on this breakout right there. There is December 7th. That's when we entered the trade. Then we come along here, another big pop to the upside, okay? That was on the 13th, and this is the day we were having our session last week. Okay. At that particular point in time, we were looking at it and saying, you know what? We can go ahead and exit that long vertical and keep, I believe it was more than 80% of our max gain and avoid the additional risk. So what we did is we opted to do that. Just to run through the math on this, we have a good understanding of that. There's our long call vertical, which was $2 wide at $23.25. It's $2 wide. It involved a debit of $1.62. When you calculate the maximum gain on a long call vertical rather than a short call vertical, previously we were looking at a short call vertical. When you calculate the gain on a long call vertical, you take the distance between the strike prices and you subtract the debit. That gives you your maximum gain. Your maximum loss is the debit. So when looking at this particular trade, when we're looking at it, our maximum gain on the trade was then, when we entered the trade, it was $2 wide minus a 62-cent debit, a $62 debit. So our maximum gain on the trade was 138, okay? Well, because of the strong movement, the underlying security, we could close this out for $1.66 credit. So if we close out at $1.66 credit, how much of that maximum gain of 138 did we have at that particular point in time? Well, let's take a peek at that. So we came in, we sold this long vertical, and in selling that long vertical, after some nice positive price movement, we picked up 166. It costed us 62 cents to get in the trade. So as far as profitability at that point, we were sitting at profitability of 104. you take the 104, which is the level of profitability we had at that time, and what percentage of that, what percentage of 104, what percentage of the maximum gain were we at that point? Well, we can take our 104 and divide that then by our 138 to see where we were at. And we're sitting at about 75% of our max gains. We're sitting about 75% of our max gain after being in about a three-week trade for 1 week. So we went ahead and decided to take that. Okay. Now the other thing we did is we had this long call, and this long call had some nice, had a nice level of profitability. And we didn't want to lose all that profitability as a result of price movement. So on this long call right here, at the same time we got out of this, we put a trailing stop on this long call right here. This is just a long call. This long, this call, you know, if you're looking at this 23 call, this 23 call, this was part of a long call vertical. This 23 call was a long call all by itself. Okay. And when we entered in that long call, it costed us 85 cents or $85. And on this same day, we were looking at level of profitability. So we wanted to lock in some of that gain without taking too much of a hit on. That was on 12. Let's see when our order was when we put this order in here on that. Let's see. Here it is right here. Here's our stop. So we put that in on 12:14, I believe. And it looks like it was, looks like that was filled. Let's see, 12:14. That's the order. And looks like it would, looks like we put it in on 12:14. It looks like it was filled on 12:14. What does that tell us? It tells us if we look at the candle for 12:14 here on WBA, and that's going to be right there. Yeah, that is a big candle. In fact, let's zoom in here a little bit just so we can kind of see. I think it's beneficial to see how these things work. Okay. So this right here, investors, in fact, let's grab a little drawing tool here just so we can identify how these things change. So this candle right here, that was the candle of our discussion. And I would suggest that during our discussion, we were probably up towards this end of the candle. We did have some nice profit. So I opted to put in a trailing stop loss. And basically what a trailing stop loss is, you put in a stop loss that says, okay, if the underlying security moves down, let me kind of put it like, let's do it like this. Let's just say for teaching purposes, I put in a trailing stop loss at say 23 cents, okay? And this is on the option, all right? 23 cent trailing stop loss. And let's say when I first enter the trade, the option is worth $1 and I have a trailing stop loss. Let's make it easier. Let's put our trailing stop loss here at 25 cents, okay? So what that means is at the time of the trade, where is my stop loss? At the time of the trade, my stop loss is sitting here at 75 cents. Because if the underlying security moves down by 25 cents, that's going to trigger my stop loss here at 75. But on the other hand, if the price of the underlying security comes up here and hits $1.50, now where's my trailing stop loss? Well, now my trailing stop loss is sitting here at 125. So you kind of get the idea. The trailing stop loss goes up with the price, but it doesn't go down with the price beyond this 25 cents right here. And that was filled, and you can see this is a big candlestick. I'm thinking we ended this thing when we were up at this end of the candlestick. Then as this thing started to droop down right here, then that took us out of our option trade. But still, it's still based on how we set that, we still should have a reasonable level of profitability on that. We'll come back over here and take a peek here. We'll go back here 30 days just to check out our trailing stop on this thing. Okay. So we entered in the trade at 85. We got taken out on our trailing stop loss at 214. So just looking at that, then we've got 214 here minus the 85. We were able to capture $129 of profitability on that one. Now, investors, anytime you use a trailing stop loss, I think it's always beneficial to see where the order was filled in relationship to the trading stop loss, because that kind of gives you an idea of the liquidity of the underlying options. You want to be a little bit careful with trailing stop losses when you're using them with options. If you see a lot of slippage between the bid and the ask price, where that thing gets triggered and where you get filled, it could provide a rather rude awakening and rather rude surprise. I remember when we put this one in, we felt comfortable with regards to the underlying slippage in relationship to that. Okay, so that was Walgreens Boot Alliance. Okay, let's go over here then and take a look at these two. We got Nike right here, and we've got that one in there for now. That's our earnings. So this is Chevron. Maybe you remember this. All this is a synthetic long stock. So as long as the underlying security is moving to the upside and the uptrend is in place, we're comfortable with this. You know, after I put this in, I saw a couple of questions over in the chat. Went, okay, Ken, when do we get out of this? Well, we have 57 days to stay in it. Okay. And this is meant to simulate a long position in a stock. So you would treat it typically how you would treat a long position in a stock. So if we come up over here to the chart and look at CVX right here, CVX right there. And let's get, so you can see that we broke out of this resistance level right here. We've come up, we have a little bit of a pause here. This is a higher high. We're okay with it moving down like this. We just want to come off of a higher low. And as long as our lows are getting higher and our highs are getting higher, we're okay staying in the trade over the course of time that we have elected. Okay. So that's it. You know, when you do a synthetic long stock, typically you're just looking at staying in the trade as long as you would ordinarily with regards to the stock. Now, there may be some situations where you may think differently about that, but usually for the most part, you're probably looking at that. So if we came over here and grabbed a channel tool, and we don't know where we're going to get a bounce here, okay? But let's say we got a bounce there. Well, we could put together a channel, something like this. Say, you know what? As long as we're in that channel, we're going to be okay. If we drop out of that channel, then perhaps we may want to make some type of an adjustment. Okay, so, and then we have over here Netflix, all right? We look at Netflix, we're thinking, oh, you know what? Netflix isn't doing so good. Actually, Netflix is doing quite well. And the reason we're showing 127.50 loss here is because I retired the short put because I had an advantageous opportunity to do that. Some of you remember on Netflix, what this is a jade lizard, okay? Kind of a crazy name, but basically a jade lizard is where you do a, when you're looking at it from a bullish standpoint, you do a short call vertical, but then you add an additional credit by selling a short put. And when you do that, your profit loss looks, and we discussed this, so I don't want to spend too much time with this, but basically your profit loss looks something like that. If that's zero, okay, then we have our profit loss. It kind of goes like this, a little bit of a down, then it goes out here forever, okay? Now this risk over here on this side, this goes down forever, okay? So you have a huge amount of risk in relationship to that short put. So if there's an opportune time to buy back that short put, then a lot of times you want to do that and get rid of all this risk, okay? And because of the strength of the move on Netflix, we did have an opportune time to buy back the short put, which leaves us with this profit loss standpoint that we're looking at right here, okay? And basically, when you break outside of that short call vertical, that's when our profit takes a little bit of a dip. But we still have profitability, and I believe that's about where we're at right now. Now, investors, I'm going through these relatively quickly because we put these on in a separate session. So if you wanted to go back and look at the archives, you could look at the archives to kind of get involved as far as the details and some of the thinking around. But the primary thing to keep in mind right here, if we're looking at Netflix, notice I have one day till expiration, so I need to do something here because both of these options are in the money. In fact, let's go ahead and close this out because they're both in the money. We want to go ahead and close them out. We do want to keep in mind that a short option can be assigned at any time up to expiration. We're one day out here. If we didn't do anything in here, this for sure would be assigned. If we weren't in a paper trading account, this could have already been assigned, okay? Let's go ahead and close it out, and then we can look at our cash flows in relationship to this, okay? We'll go ahead and close out our short call vertical where we sold the lower strike price. We bought the higher strike price, and that was part of a second credit on our Jade Lizard. So let's go ahead and do this. We're going to choose create closing order, buy that vertical back. There it is right there. Boy, that's a big difference, isn't it? The mid right here is 195. And by the way, investors, this is part of the challenge sometimes that you'll run into as your options get deeper and deeper into the money. There is a tendency for the slippage, in other words, the difference between the bid and the ask price to widen out. I'm looking at this. I'm thinking, you know, that is kind of wide, okay? Let's go ahead and see if we can get it at the 195, but we may have to come up here closer to the natural. Going to come over here and do a confirm and send right here. Selecting an option strategy. We'll go ahead and send that. And we got filled. Okay, so we got filled there, and we got filled at 195. Again, this is a paper trading account. It tends to be a little bit more forgiving than a live trading account. But let's look at our cash flows in relationship to our Netflix trade then. All of our cash flows in relationship to that Jade Lizard we did. So come here in NFLX. Right here, we want to go back 30 days, okay? And so we close this out at a debit. That's our short call vertical. We close that out at $1.95 debit. So I'm just going to make a note here. That was $1.95 debit to close that out. Now I want to identify that was our vertical, which was the 482.50, 485. Where is our put? Where's our short put? Our short put is down here, this 455. When we sold that, we got a 450 credit. And when we sold our short vertical, we got an additional credit. So our overall credit when we entered this trade was $5.25. I'm going to note that. $5.25 was our overall credit. This was our entry of our Jade Lizard. There's our short put, and there's our short call vertical. Overall credit, $5.25. Now, we came in, and by the way, investors, I've done some additional trades here on Netflix, okay? So some of this is not really applicable. So when you look at all this and say, hey, Ken, what about that 467.50? Wasn't part of this trade, okay? That was part of a different trade down here, okay? This is the trade, this is the Jade Lizard we're looking at, okay? Okay, well, there was an opportune time to come in and buy back that put as the price was moving up nicely. So I was able to come in and buy that back for 22 cents. Okay, so I'm going to note that 22 cents to buy back that put. So let's look at our cash flows now that our Jade Lizard is complete and see how that all played out in the end. Come over here. And so we started off here with then $525. That was our credit. Okay, we're going to subtract from that our 195, close out that vertical. Okay, then we're going to subtract our $22 right here. That left us with a total credit here of $308. So that trade worked out okay, due in large part just because the overall market has been rather bullish, and that's been fortunate for us. Now, sometimes I say this with a smile, investors, but it is kind of true. Sometimes we all feel like geniuses when the market is in a big bullish run. And the reason I bring that up is because you just don't want to get overconfident. Okay. All right. So just be mindful of that and be mindful of some of the different things you can do to manage trades, particularly when some of these trades get into some difficulty. All right, investors. Well, let's take a look at a straddle strangle swap. Looks like we have a few minutes over here. I do want to come over here in the chat window. Hey, Ken, we'll catch you later. Thanks for joining us here today. And it looks like Barb's doing a great job of addressing your questions here. So big thanks to Barb. Let's kind of get started on a straddle strangle swap. I'll probably complete this following our discussion, but let's come up here to the analyze page here. Okay, we're going to stay on Netflix right here. Now, on a straddle strangle swap, one of the advantages of a straddle strangle swap is it is not a done deal. It is not an overnight done deal. Now, sometimes that can be a negative. All right. Because if the price cooperates for you on a straddle strangle swap and you have these different time periods that you are still working with, it's nice to have that versatility. But if you just would have been in the iron condor, you basically know what's happened and there wouldn't be any, and you wouldn't feel any particular need, okay, to make adjustments. However, there is a sweet spot on the straddle strangle swap after the earnings announcement occurs, and sometimes investors will go ahead and exit at that time. In fact, I would say that a fair number of investors that are fairly risk averse would would most certainly look to exit that time. But the nice thing about a straddle swing swap, though, if it doesn't really go for you immediately, but you feel good about possibly about things returning to the mean and some of those other things, it does give you a great amount of versatility as far as handling adverse conditions going forward. Now, looking right here at our option chain on a straddle strangle swap, rather than doing everything up here where we have one day till expiration, we'll come in here on the one day to expiration right here. And right here, we would sell a straddle. I'm going to abbreviate these guys, okay? But sell a straddle. And what does it mean when we sell a straddle? Well, we sell the at-the-money call and we sell the at-the-money put. Now, we're going to be looking at doing this not on Netflix, but we're going to be looking at doing this on Nike. Okay, so I got to remember to change that symbol right there, okay? So we're going to sell that straddle right there. Now, when you sell a straddle, what does your risk-reward graph look like? Well, it looks like this. Kind of like this, where that's zero profitability. And then these two guys right here, this goes way down here. This one here, which represents a short call, this one, your risk is infinity. And this one, your risk is the strike price minus whatever credit you receive, which is still a huge amount of risk. So you have this enormous amount of risk. So in order to alleviate that risk, sometimes we'll come out here at a later time, later date here, we'll just say 36 days, coming out here about 36 days, and we'll buy a strangle. Okay, so we sold the at the money right here. Okay. Now we're going in order to mitigate this risk, we're going to buy a strangle. That's going to be long out of the money options. And that's going to level our risk off over on one side. It's going to level our risk off over on the other side. So we don't have to worry from a theoretical perspective about this unlimited risk. Now our risk reward changes to something like this. Now, when you first bring up one of these things, and by the way, when you add that as well, this thing kind of goes to a point like that. Actually, it's that flat thing you actually have more of a point going on like this. One of the things to keep in mind when you do a straddle strangle swap is back month changes of implied volatility, because back month changes of implied volatility can change things dramatically in relationship to what your risk reward looks like right here. Okay. All right. So with that, it's kind of a little bit of an intro here. Get rid of that and get us back over here. And checking our time. So we'll come over here. I'm going to go and do Nike right here. NKE. There's Nike. And typically what we do in the way of setting up a straddle strangle swap is we'd go add simulated trades over here. And, you know, do I already have something in here on that? I've got this thing going on. That's our iron. Oh, you know what? That's just our existing. Now let's choose high positions. Yep. Yeah, I got something else in there. Okay. Typically what we do on a straddle strangle swap, folks, would come in here then and find, let's just go to 8 strike prices here. Find the short straddle. So we're sitting here at about 122. So we'll get here to 122. I do a right click right here. I choose analyze buy trade because these usually result in a debit. I come over here to deep and wide. I probably want to go out at least 4 periods as far as getting out that one that's 36 days. I want to go down 4 option chains. I also want to go about, I don't know that I need to go 4 strike wides. Why don't we go with, let's do 2 strike wides. We'll come over here and choose double diagonal, and there's our straddle strangle swap right there. Okay. So that brings that up. Double diagonal. Let's take our iron condor off of here. Can I delete that? Yeah, I can. Okay. So there it is. There's our little credit right here. And this is what our straddle strangle swap looks like. Now, right now, it looks pretty good, right? In fact, if I pull these guys out here and I pull these guys in here, that's looking pretty good at this point, okay? But when I make a change for back month implied volatility, it will change the complexity of this completely. We don't have time to do that here today, okay? But I'll try to put this trade on and maybe take a couple screenshots following our session here. But let's go ahead and wrap things up here for today, okay? All right. All righty, investors. So let's come over here then and see how we did. All right. So what do we want to do here today? Well, we want to do a quick review of market conditions. I believe we did that. We wanted to discuss which option strategies benefit from current market conditions. We talked about doing an earnings trade, kind of a potential profit overnight type of an earnings trade. And we looked at an iron condor and we put together some samples on that. We didn't quite have time to squeeze on our straddle strangle swap. We'll see if I can pop that on between now and when the market closes, okay? Hey, just a little reminder, you can follow me on Twitter. My Twitter handle is at KenRoseCS. I post things on Twitter related to this area, as well as others investing. I also encourage you to follow Barb on Twitter. She posts a lot of great information over there. That's going to be at Barb Armstrong CS. Also, don't forget to circle your calendars for Friday. Friday's at 12 noon, I believe it is. Barb teaches an excellent trading a smaller account. Okay. Hey, everybody. Well, I got my Christmas jacket on. That's to wish everybody a Merry Christmas and a Happy Hanukkah, however you choose to celebrate your holidays. I hope they are great and wonderful for you. Best of success in your investing, and hope to see you back here again next time. Bye, everybody. We'll catch you later, and thanks again.